Ah, did you hear what I was playing, Lane?
I thought it polite not to listen, sir.
No, I'm sorry for that. For your sake, I know it's played accurately. Anyone can play accurately. But I play with such wonderful expression. As far as the piano is concerned, sentiment is my forte.
Yes, sir.
And speaking of the science of life, have you prepared the cucumber sandwiches for Lady Bracknell?
Yes, sir.
And by the way, Lane.
Sir?
I see from your book, on last Thursday, when Lord Shoreman and Mr. Worthing were dining with me, that 8 bottles of champagne are entered as having been consumed.
Yes, sir. 8 bottles and a pint.
Hmm. Now, why is it that at a bachelor's establishment, the servants invariably drink the champagne? I ask merely for information.
I attribute it to the superior quality of the wine, sir. I have often observed that in married households, the champagne is very rarely of a first-rate brand.
Good heavens, is marriage so demoralising as that?
I believe it is a very pleasant state, sir, not having had much experience of it up to the present. I was married once, but that was more a consequence of a misunderstanding between myself and a younger person.
Mm. Not sure I'm all that much interested in your family life, Lane.
No, sir, it's not a very interesting subject, and I never think of it myself.
Mm, very natural, I'm sure. That will do, Lane. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Lane's views on marriage seem somewhat lax. Really, if the lower orders don't set us a good example, then what on earth is the use of them? They seem, as a class, to have absolutely no sense of moral responsibility.
Mr. Ernest Worthing.
My dear Ernest, brings you to town.
Oh, pleasure, pleasure. What else would bring a man anywhere? Eating as usual, I see, Algy.
I believe it is customary in good society to take some slight refreshment at 5 o'clock. Where have you been since Thursday?
In the country.
What on earth do you do there?
Oh, when one is in town, one amuses oneself. When one is in the country, one amuses other people. It is excessively boring.
And who are these people that you amuse?
Neighbours, neighbours.
Hmm. Got nice neighbours in your part of Shropshire?
Perfectly horrid. I don't speak to one of them.
Hmm. How immensely you must amuse them. Mm-hmm. By the way, Shropshire is your county, is it not?
Eh? Shropshire? Oh, yes, yes. Why, hello. Why all of these carps? Or why the cucumber sandwiches? Why such extravagance from one so young? Who is coming to tea?
Merely Aunt Augusta and Gwendolyn.
Ah, how perfectly delightful.
Hmm. That is all very well, but I'm afraid Aunt Augusta won't quite approve of your being here.
May I ask why?
My dear fellow, the way you flirt with Gwendolyn is perfectly disgraceful. That's almost as bad as the way Gwendolyn flirts with you.
I am in love with Gwendolyn. I have come up to town expressly to propose to her.
I thought you said you'd come up for pleasure. I call that business.
How utterly unromantic you are.
Oh, my dear fellow, there is nothing romantic in proposing. It is perfectly romantic to be in love, but there is nothing romantic but a definite proposal. Why, one may be accepted. One usually is, I believe. Mm-hmm. And then the excitement is all over. The very essence of romance is uncertainty. If ever I get married, I'll certainly try to forget the fact.
I have no doubt about that, dear fellow. The divorce courts were specially invented for those whose memories have become so curiously constituted.
Mm. Well, there is no use speculating on that subject. Divorces were made in heaven. Please, don't touch your cucumber sandwiches. You're ordered specially for Aunt Augusta.
Well, you've been eating them all of this time.
It's quite a different matter. She is my aunt. Have some bread and butter. The bread and butter is from Gwendolyn. Gwendolyn is devoted to bread and butter.
And lovely bread and butter it is too.
Oh, my dear fellow, you need not eat it as if you were going to eat it all. You behave as if you were married to her already. Hmm? You are not married to her already, and I don't think you ever will be.
What on earth do you mean?
Well, in the first place, girls never marry the man they flirt with. Girls don't think it right.
That is nonsense.
It isn't. It is a great truth. It accounts for the extraordinary number of bachelors that one sees all over the place. And in the second place, I don't give my consent.
Your consent?
Oh, my dear fellow, Gwendolyn is my first cousin. And before I allow you to marry her, you will have to clear up the whole question of Cecily.
Cecily? What on earth do you mean? What do you mean, Algy, by Cecily? I don't know anyone with the name of Cecily.
Hmm, name. Bring me the cigarette case that Mr. Worthing left in the smoking room the last time he dined here.
Very good, sir.
You mean to tell me you've had my cigarette case this whole time? I wish to goodness you would have told me. I've sent several letters to Scotland Yard about it. I was very nearly offering a large reward.
Well, I wish you would offer one. I have to be more than usually hard up at the moment.
There is absolutely no reason for me to offer a large reward now that the thing has been found.
Well, I think that's rather mean of you, Ernest. I must say. That, however, it makes no matter. But now that I look upon the inscription, I find that the thing isn't yours after all.
Of course it's mine. You've seen me with it 100 times, and you've no right whatsoever to read what is written inside. It is a very ungentlemanly thing to do, to read a private cigarette case.
It's absurd to have a hard and fast rule about what one should read and what one shouldn't. Why, half of modern culture depends on what one shouldn't read.
I'm quite well aware of the fact, and I don't propose to discuss modern culture with you. It is not the sort of thing one discusses in private. I simply want my cigarette case back.
Yes, but this isn't your cigarette case. This cigarette case is a present from somebody of the name of Cecily. And you said you didn't know anyone of that name.
Well, if you must know, Cecily is my aunt.
Your aunt?
Yes, a lovely old lady too. Lives in Tunbridge Wells. Look, just give it back to me, Algy.
Yes, but why does she call herself Little Cecily if she's your aunt and lives in Tunbridge Wells? Little Cecily with her fondest love.
My dear fellow, what on earth is there in that? Some aunts are tall, some aunts are not so tall. That is a matter that an aunt should be allowed to entirely make for herself. You seem to think that all aunts should be like your aunt. That is absurd. Now, for heaven's sake, give me my cigarette case back.
Yes, but why does your aunt call you her uncle? From little Cecily, with her fondest love, to her dear uncle, Jack. Now, there is no objection, I admit, to an aunt being a small aunt. But why an aunt, no matter what her size may be, should call her own nephew her uncle? I can't quite make it out. Besides, your name isn't Jack at all. It's Ernest.
My name is not Ernest. It's Jack.
You have always told me your name was Ernest. I have introduced you as Ernest. You answered to the name of Ernest. You are, in fact, the most earnest-looking person I ever met in my life. Well, it's perfectly absurd you're saying your name isn't Ernest. It's written on your cards, and here it is, one of them. Mr. Ernest Worthing, B4, the Albany. Now, I shall keep this as proof your name is Ernest, if you ever choose to deny it to me, to Gwendolyn, or to anyone else.
Well, my name is Ernest in town and Jack in the country, and the cigarette case was given to me in the country.
Yes, but that is still not account for the fact that your small aunt Cecily, who lives in Tunbridge Wells, was you, her dear uncle. Come, dear boy, I'd much rather have the thing out at once.
Yeah, Algy, you speak exactly as if you were a dentist. It is very vulgar to speak as a dentist when one is not a dentist. It produces a false impression.
My dear fellow, that is exactly what dentists always do. Now, come on, tell me the whole thing. I may mention, however, I have always suspected you of being a secret and confirmed Bunburyist. Now, I'm quite sure of it.
Bunburyist? What on earth do you mean by Bunburyist?
Well, I shall reveal to you the meaning of that incomparable expression as soon as you are kind enough to reveal to me why you were Ernest in town and Jack in the country.
Very well. Produce my cigarette case first.
Here it is. Now produce your explanation and pray make it improbable.
My dear fellow, there is nothing improbable about my explanation at all. In fact, it is quite ordinary. The late Mr. Thomas Cardew, who adopted me as a young boy, made me in his will guardian to his granddaughter, Miss Cecily Cardew. Miss Cardew, who refers to me as her uncle, through motives of respect that you could not possibly begin to appreciate, lives with me at my country house, under the charge of our admirable governess, Miss Prism.
Yes, now where is that place in the country, by the way?
That is nothing to you, dear boy. You are not to be invited. I may tell you quite candidly that the place is not in Shropshire.
Well, I suspected that. I had Bunbury all over Shropshire on 2 separate occasions. Now, go on. Why are you Ernest in town and Jack in the country?
My dear fellow, I'm not really certain you can understand my true motives. You are hardly serious enough. When one is placed in the position of guardian, one must take a very high moral tone on all subjects. It is one's duty to do so. And as a high moral tone can hardly be said to conduce much to one's health or to one's happiness. In order to get up to town as often as I liked, I have always pretended to have a younger brother of the name of Ernest, who lives in the Albany, and gets into the most dreadful scrapes. That, my dear fellow, is the whole truth. Pure and simple.
Well, the truth is rarely pure and never simple. Modern life would be very tedious if there were. Modern literature, a complete impossibility.
That wouldn't at all be a bad thing.
Literary criticism is not your forte, my dear fellow. Don't try it. And you should leave that to people that haven't been to a university. They do it so well in the daily papers. Now, what you really are is a Bunburyist. I was quite right in saying you're a Bunburyist. You're one of the most advanced Bunburyists I know.
What on earth do you mean?
Well, you have invented a very useful younger brother called Ernest, in order that you may be able to disappear to town whenever you choose. I have invented a perfectly invaluable invalid called Bunbury, in order that I may be able to disappear to the country whenever I choose. Bunbury is perfectly invaluable. Why, if it wasn't for Bunbury's extraordinary bad health, for instance, I wouldn't be able to dine with you tonight at Willis's. Why, I've been really engaged to Aunt Augusta for more than a week.
But I've not asked you to dine anywhere with me tonight.
I know. You're absurdly careless about sending out invitations. Nothing upsets one more than not having received an invitation.
You had much better stay for dinner with your Aunt Augusta.
My dear fellow, I haven't the smallest intention of doing anything of the kind. In the first place, I dined there on Monday, and once a week is quite enough to dine with one's own relations. In the second place, whenever I do dine there, I'm always treated as a member of the family, and either sent down with no woman at all, or two. In the third place, I know perfectly well who she'll place me next to tonight. Place me next to Mary Farquhar. Always flirts with her own husband across the dinner table. That is not very pleasant. Indeed, it isn't even decent. That sort of thing is enormously on the increase. The amount of women in London who flirt with their own husbands is perfectly disgraceful. It looks so bad. It is simply washing one's own clean linen in public. And besides, now that I know you're a Bunburyist, I naturally want to talk to you about Bunbury. I want to tell you the rules.
My dear fellow, I am not a Bunburyist at all. If Gwendolyn accepts me, I'm going to kill my brother. Indeed, I think I'm going to kill him in any case. Cecily's a little too interested in him. It is rather a bore. So I'm going to get rid of Ernest. And I suggest you do the same with your Mr. Butler. Your invalid friend with the absurd name.
Well, nothing will induce me to part ways with Bunbury. And if you ever get married, which seems to me extremely problematic, you'll be very glad to know Bunbury. A man who marries without knowing Bunbury has a very tedious time of it.
That is nonsense. If I ever marry a charming, sweet girl like Gwendolyn, and she's the only girl in my whole life I ever met that I would marry, I certainly would not want to know Bunbury.
Well, then your wife will. You don't seem to realise that in married life, three is company and two is none.
That, my dear fellow, is the theory the corrupt French drama has been propounding for the last 50 years.
Yes, and that the happy English home has proved in half the time.
Don't be cynical. It's perfectly easy to be cynical.
Oh, my dear fellow, it isn't easy to be anything nowadays. Such a lot of beastly competition about. That must be Aunt Augusta. Only relatives or creditors ever ring in such a Wagnerian manner. Now, if I can get her out of the way for 10 minutes, so that you might have an opportunity of proposing to Gwendolyn, I dine with you tonight at Willis's.
I suppose, sir, if you want to.
Yes, but you must be serious about it. I hate people who are not serious about meals. So shallow of them.
Lady Bracknell and Miss Fairfax.
Good afternoon, dear Algernon. I hope you are behaving very well.
Well, I'm feeling very well, Aunt Augusta.
That's not quite the same thing. In fact, the two things rarely go together.
Dear me, Gwendolyn, you are smart.
I am always smart. Am I not, Mr. Wilde?
You are quite perfect, Miss Fairfax.
Oh, I hope I am not that. It would leave no room for development. And I intend to develop in many directions.
I'm sorry if we are a little late, Algernon, but I was obliged to call on dear Lady Harbury. I haven't been there since her poor husband's death. I never saw a woman so altered. She looks quite 20 years younger. And now I'll have a cup of tea and one of those nice cucumber sandwiches you promised me.
Certainly, Aunt Augusta.
Won't you come and sit here, Gwendolyn?
Thanks, Mama. I'm quite comfortable where I am.
Good heavens, Lane. Why are there no cucumber sandwiches? I ordered them specially.
Oh, there were no cucumbers at the market this morning, sir. I went down twice.
No cucumbers?
No, sir. Not even for ready money.
Yes, well, that will do, Lane. Thank you. I am greatly distressed, Aunt Augusta. About there being no cucumbers, not even for ready money.
It really makes no matter, Algernon. I had some crumpets with Lady Harvey, who seems to me to be living entirely for pleasure now.
Yes, I hear her hair has turned white gold from grief.
It certainly has changed its colour. From what cause, I of course cannot say. I've quite a treat for you tonight, Algernon. I'm going to send you down with Mary Farfar. She is such a nice woman. Thank you. And so attentive to her husband. It's delightful to watch them.
I'm afraid, Aunt Augusta, I shall have to give up the pleasure of dining with you tonight after all.
I hope not, Algernon. It would put my table completely out. Your uncle would have to dine upstairs. Fortunately, he is accustomed to that.
Well, it is a great bore, and I need hardly say a terrible disappointment to me. But the fact is, I've just received a telegram that said that my poor friend Bunbury is very ill again, and they seem to think I should be with him.
It is very strange. This Mr. Bunbury seems to suffer from curiously bad health.
Yes, poor Bunbury is a dreadful invalid.
Well, I must say, Algernon, that I think it is high time that Mr. Bunbury made up his mind whether he was going to live or to die. This shilly-shallying with the question is absurd. Nor do I in any way approve of the modern sympathy with invalids. I consider it morbid. Illness of any kind is hardly a thing to be encouraged in others. Health is the primary duty of life. I'm always telling that to your poor uncle, but he never seems to take much notice as far as the improvement in his health goes. I should be much obliged if you would ask Mr. Bunbury from me not to have a relapse on Saturday, for I rely on you to arrange my music for me. It is my last reception, and one wants something that will encourage conversation, particularly at the end of the season when everyone has practically said whatever it was they had to say, which in most cases was probably not much.
Well, I shall speak to Bunbury, Aunt Augusta, if he is still conscious, and I think I can promise you he'll be all right by Saturday. Of course, the music is a great difficulty. You see, if one plays good music, people don't listen. And if one plays bad music, people don't talk. But I'll run over the programme up, Dawn, if you'll kindly follow me into the other room for a moment.
Thank you, Algernon. It is very thoughtful of you. I'm sure the programme will be delightful. After a few expurgations, French songs I cannot possibly allow. People always seem to think they are improper and either look shocked, which is vulgar, or laugh, which is worse. But German sounds a thoroughly respectable language, and indeed I believe is so. Gwendolyn, you will accompany me.
Yes, Mama.
Charming day it has been, Miss Fairfax.
Pray don't talk to me about the weather, Mr. Worthing. Whenever people talk to me about the weather, I always feel quite certain that they mean something else. And that makes me so nervous.
I do mean something else.
I thought so. In fact, I'm never wrong.
And I would like to be allowed to take advantage of Lady Bracknell's temporary absence.
I would certainly advise you to do so. Mama has a way of coming back suddenly into a room that I've often had to speak to her about.
Gwendolyn. Ever since I met you, I have admired you more than any other girl I have ever met since I met you.
Yes, I'm quite well aware of the fact. And I often wish that in public, at any rate, that you'd been more demonstrative. For me, you have always had an irresistible fascination. Even before I met you, I was far from indifferent to you. We live, as I hope you know, Mr. Worthing, in an age of ideals. The fact is constantly mentioned in the more expensive monthly magazines and has reached the provincial pulpits, I am told. And my ideal has always been to love someone of the name of Ernest. There is something in that name that inspires absolute confidence. The moment Algernon first mentioned to me that he had a friend called Ernest, I knew I was destined to love you.
You really love me, Gwendolyn?
Passionately.
Oh, my darling, you don't know how happy you've made me.
My own Ernest.
But you don't really mean that you couldn't love me if my name was not Ernest.
But your name is Ernest.
Oh, yes, 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 but what if my name was something else? Do you mean to say you could not love me then?
It is clearly a metaphysical speculation, and like most metaphysical speculations, has very little reference at all to the actual facts of real life as we know them.
Personally, darling, to speak quite frankly, I don't much care for the name of Ernest. I don't think it suits me at all.
It suits you perfectly. It is a divine name. It has a music of its own. It produces vibrations.
Well, really, Gwendolyn, I think there are a lot of much nicer names. I think Jack, for instance, a very good name.
Jack? No, there is very little rep music in the name Jack, if any at all, indeed. It does not thrill. It produces absolutely no vibrations. I have known several Jacks, and they all, without exception, were more than usually plain. Besides, Jack is a notorious domesticity for John, and I pity any woman who is married to a man called John. She would probably never be allowed to know the entrancing pleasure of a single moment's solitude. The only really safe name is Ernest.
Gwendolyn, I must get christened at once. I mean, of course, we must get married at once.
Married, Mr. Wilde?
Well, surely. I've told you, Miss Fairfax, how much I love you, and led me to believe that you're not entirely indifferent to me.
I adore you, but you haven't proposed to me yet. The subject of marriage has not been touched on at all.
Well, may I propose to you now?
I think it would be an admirable idea. And to spare you any possible disappointment, Mr. Worthing, I think it's only fair to tell you quite frankly beforehand that I'm fully determined to accept you.
Good. Gwendolyn.
Yes, Mr. Worthing, what have you got to say to me?
You know what I've got to say to you.
Yes, but you don't say it.
Gwendolyn, will you marry me?
Of course I will, darling. How long have you been about it? I'm afraid you've had very little experience in how to propose.
My own one. I've never loved anyone in the world but you.
Yes, but some men propose for practice. I know my brother Gerald does. All my girlfriends tell me so. What wonderful eyes you have, Ernest. They are quite wonderful. I hope you will always look at me just like that, especially when there are other people present.
Mr. Worthing, rise, sir, from this semi-recumbent posture. It is most indecorous.
Mama, I beg you to retire. This is no place for you. Besides, Mr. Worthing is not quite finished yet.
Finished what, may I ask?
I am engaged to be married to Mr. Worthing, Mama.
Pardon me. You are not engaged to anyone. When you do become engaged to someone, I, or your father, should his health permitting, will inform you of the fact. An engagement should come on a young girl as a surprise. Pleasant or unpleasant, as the case may be, it is hardly a matter she could be allowed to arrange for herself. And now, I have a few questions to put to you, Mr. Worthing. While I am making these inquiries, you, Gwendolyn, will wait for me below in the carriage.
Mama!
In the carriage, Gwendolyn! Gwendolyn, the carriage.
Yes, Mama.
You can take a seat, Mr. Worthing.
Thank you, Lady Bracknell. I prefer standing.
I feel bound to tell you that you are not down on my list of eligible young men, although I have the same list as the dear Duchess of Bolton has. We work together, in fact. However, I am quite prepared to enter your name should your answers be what a really affectionate mother requires. Do you smoke?
Well, I must admit I you smoke.
I am glad to hear it. A man should always have an occupation of some kind. There are far too many idle men in London as it is. How old are you?
29.
A very good age to be married at. I have always been of opinion that a man who desires to be married should know either everything or nothing. Which do you know?
I know nothing, Lady Bracknell.
I am pleased to hear it. I do not approve of anything that tampers with natural ignorance. Ignorance is like a delicate exotic fruit. Touch it and the bloom is gone. The whole theory of modern education is radically unsound. Fortunately, in England at any rate, education produces no effect whatsoever. If it did, it would prove a serious danger to the upper classes and probably lead to acts of violence in Grosvenor Square. What is your income?
Between 7,000 and 8,000 a year.
In land or in investments?
In investments, chiefly.
That is satisfactory. What between the duties expected of one during one's lifetime and the duties exacted from one after one's death, land has ceased to be either a profit or a pleasure. It gives one position, prevents one from keeping it up. That's all that can be said about land.
I have a country house with some land, of course, attached to it. About 1,500 acres. Of course, I don't rely on that for any real income. In fact, as far as I can make out, the poachers are the only people that can make anything out of it.
A country house? How many bedrooms? Well, that one can be cleared up afterwards. You have a townhouse, I hope. A girl with a simple, unspoiled nature like Gwendolyn could hardly be expected to reside in the country.
I have a townhouse in Belgrave Square, but it is on let by the year to Lady Bloxham. Of course, I can get it back whenever I like at 6 months' notice.
Lady Bloxham? I don't know her.
Oh, she goes around very little. She is a lady considerably advanced in years.
Oh, nowadays that is no guarantee of respectability of character. What number in Belgrave Square?
149.
I thought there was something. The unfashionable side. However, that could easily be altered.
Do you mean the fashion or the side?
Both, if necessary, I presume. What are your politics?
I'm afraid, Lady Bracknell, I really have none. I'm a Liberal Unionist.
Oh, they count as Tories. They dine with us, or come in the evening at any rate. Now, to minor matters. Are your parents living?
I have lost both of my parents, Lady Bracknell.
To lose one parent, Mr. Welling, may be regarded as a misfortune. To lose both looks like carelessness. Who was your father? He was evidently a man of some wealth. Was he born in what the radical papers call the purple of commerce? Or did he rise from the ranks of the aristocracy?
I'm afraid, Lady Bracknell, I really do not know. I told you that I seem to have lost my parents. It would be closer to the truth to say my parents seem to have lost me. I don't know who I am by birth. I was found.
Found?
Yes, sir. The late Mr. Thomas Cardew, a gentleman of very kind and charitable disposition, found me and gave me the name of Worthing because he happened to have a train ticket in his pocket to Worthing at the time. Worthing is a place in Sussex. It is a seaside resort.
Where did the gentleman who had a first-class ticket for this seaside resort find you?
In a handbag.
A handbag?
Yes, Lady Bracknell, I was in a handbag. A brown leather handbag with handles. A very ordinary handbag, in fact.
In what locality did this Mr. James or Thomas Cardew come across this ordinary handbag?
The cloakroom at Victoria Station. It was given to him in mistake of his own.
The cloakroom at Victoria Station?
Yes, the Brighton line.
The line is immaterial. Mr. Worthing, I confess I find myself somewhat bewildered by what you have just told me. To be born, or at any rate bred, in a handbag, whether it has handles or not, seems to me to display a contempt for the ordinary decencies of family life that remind one of the worst excesses of the French Revolution. And I presume you know what that unfortunate movement led to. As for the particular locality in which the handbag was found, a cloakroom at a railway station might serve to conceal a social indiscretion. Has probably indeed been used for that purpose before now, but it could hardly be regarded as a recognised position for an assured place in good society.
But then, Lady Bracknell, I ask what you would have me do. It is needless to say I would do anything to ensure Gwendolyn's happiness.
I would strongly advise you, Mr. Worthing, to try and acquire some relations as soon as possible, and to make a definite effort to produce, at any rate, one parent of either sex before the season is quite over.
I don't really see how I could do that, Lady Bracknell. I can produce the handbag whenever I like. It is in my cloakroom at home. I really think that that should satisfy you, Lady Bracknell.
Me, sir? What has it to do with me? Well, you can hardly imagine that I and Lord Bracknell would dream of allowing our only daughter, a girl brought up with the utmost care, to marry into a cloakroom and form an alliance with a parcel. Good morning, Mr. Worthing.
Well, good morning.
For goodness sake, Algy, stop playing that ghastly tune! How idiotic you are!
Didn't it go off all right, old boy? You don't mean to say Gwendolyn refused you? She's always refusing people. It is a way she has. I think it most ill-natured of her.
Gwendolyn is as right as a trivet. As far as she is concerned, we are engaged. Her mother is perfectly disgraceful. Never met such a gorgon. I don't really know what a gorgon is, but I'm pretty certain that Lady Bracknell is one. In either case, she is a monster, without being a myth, which I think is unfair. I'm sorry, Algy. I suppose it is very wrong of me to speak of your own relations this way before you.
Well, my dear fellow, I love hearing my relations abused. It is the only thing that makes me put up with them at all. See, relations are simply a tedious pack of people who haven't got the remotest idea of how to live, and the smallest instinct about when to die.
That is absolute nonsense.
It isn't.
I'm not going to argue with you on the subject. You always want to argue about things.
Well, that is exactly what things were originally made for.
On my life, if I believed that, I would shoot myself. You don't think that there's any chance that Gwendolyn could become like her mother in, say, 150 years' time, do you?
Well, all women become like their mothers. That is their tragedy. No man does, that's his.
Is that clever?
It is perfectly phrased, and quite as true as any observation in civilised life should be.
I'm sick of hearing things from clever people. You can't go anywhere without meeting clever people these days. The thing has become quite a public nuisance. I wish to goodness there are a few fools left.
There are.
I would certainly like to meet them. What on earth do they talk about?
The fools. Though, why, the clever people, of course.
What fools?
Oh, by the way, did you tell Gwendolyn the truth about your being Ernest in town and Jack in the country?
My dear fellow, the truth is not the sort of thing one tells to a nice, sweet, refined girl like Gwendolyn. What ideas you have on how to behave to a woman?
Well, the only way to behave to a woman is to make love to her if she is pretty, or to somebody else if she is plain.
That is absolute nonsense.
And what about your brother? What about the profligate Ernest?
By the end of the week, I shall have gotten rid of him. I shall say he died suddenly in Paris of apoplexy. Lots of people die of apoplexy quite suddenly, don't they?
Yes, but it's hereditary, my dear fellow. The sort of thing that runs in families. You'd much rather say something like a severe chill.
Are you certain a severe chill is not hereditary or anything of the kind?
Of course it isn't.
Very well then, that's settled. My poor brother Ernest is carried off suddenly in Paris by a severe chill. And that gets rid of him.
Yes, but didn't you say the young Miss Cardew was particularly fond of your poor brother, Ernest? Won't she feel his loss a great deal?
Hmm,
No, Cecily is not a silly romantic girl, I'm pleased to say. She's got a capital appetite, goes on long walks, and pays no attention at all to her studies.
I'd rather like to see this Cecily.
I shall make certain that you never do. She's excessively pretty and only just 18.
Well, have you told Gwendolyn yet? You have an excessively pretty ward who is only just 18.
One does not blurt these things out to people. Gwendolyn and Cecily are perfectly certain to be extremely great friends. I bet you anything you like that after half an hour after they have met, they will be calling each other sister.
Yes, but women only do that after calling each other a lot of other things first. Now, if you want to get a good table, we really must go and dress. Do you know it's nearly 7?
Oh, it is always nearly 7.
But I'm hungry.
I never knew when you weren't.
What should we do after dinner? Perhaps go to the theatre?
Oh, no, I loathe listening.
Perhaps the club?
No, I loathe talking.
Well, we might trot around the Empire at 10.
No, I loathe walking around. It is so silly.
What on earth shall we do then?
Nothing.
Well, it's awfully hard work doing nothing. However, I don't mind hard work when there is no definite object of any kind.
Miss Fairfax.
Really, Gwendolyn, upon my word.
Algy, kindly turn your back. I have something very particular to say to Mr. Worthing.
Gwendolyn, I'm not sure I can allow this at all.
Algy, you always adopt a strictly immoral attitude towards life. I don't think you're quite old enough to do that.
Miss Gwendolyn.
Ernest, we may never be married. From the look on Mama's face, I fear we never shall. Few parents nowadays pay any regard to what their children have to say to them. The old-fashioned respect for the young is fast dying out. Any influence I had over Mama I lost at the age of 3. But although she may prevent us from becoming husband and wife, and I may marry someone else, and marry often, nothing that she can possibly do can alter my eternal devotion to you.
My dear Gwendolyn.
The story of your romantic origin, as related to me by Mama, with unpleasing comments, has naturally stirred the deeper fibres of my nature. Your Christian name has an irresistible fascination. The simplicity of your character makes you exquisitely incomprehensible to me. Your town address at the Albany I have, what is your address in the country?
Manor House, Wilton, Hertfordshire.
There is a good postal service, I suppose. It may be necessary to do something desperate. That, of course, will require careful consideration. I will communicate with you daily.
My darling.
How long do you remain in town?
Until Monday.
Good. Algy, you may turn around now.
Thank you, but I've turned around already.
You may also ring the bell.
May I see you to your carriage, my darling?
Certainly.
I will see Miss Fairfax out.
Very good, sir.
Glass of sherry, Lane.
Yes, sir.
Tomorrow, Lane, I'm going Bunburying.
Yes, sir.
I shall probably not be back until Monday. You can lay out my dress clothes, my smoking jacket, and all the Bunburying suits.
Yes, sir.
I hope tomorrow is a fine day, Lane.
It never is, sir.
You're a perfect pessimist, Lane.
I do my best to give satisfaction, sir.
Now there is the smartest, most intelligent, most beautiful girl I've ever met. The only girl in all my life that I've ever loved. And what on earth do you find so amusing?
Oh, just concerned about my poor friend Bunbury, that's all.
If you're not careful, your friend Bunbury will get you into a serious scrape one day.
Oh, I love scrapes. They're the only thing that isn't serious.
Oh, that is nonsense. You never talk anything but nonsense.
Nobody ever does.
My name's Nathan Spencer. I play Algernon Moncrieff in The Importance of Being Earnest.
And my name is Rory Jocelyn. I play the part of Jack Worthing in The Importance of Being Earnest. I have been involved in a period drama last year, which was Doll's House, where I played a much older character. The challenge with this one is, rather than playing somebody outside of my acting age, I'm playing someone within my acting age.
That's a challenge.
I actually find that, I don't know, it's more challenging to play someone older than yourself, but it's a different type of challenge, because when you're playing someone older than yourself, you have to learn their mannerisms. And in a way, it's It's harder because you've got to make it more believable, but knowing what the mannerisms are seem easier.
Yes, I thought it would have been easier to play someone who's in your own...
Well, it's easier to actually act it and be believable in it, but it's harder to... Because you are that age, it's harder for you to sort of distinguish what you should be acting like in the past and how you normally act in the present.
I see.
It's trying to separate past and present and making majoritively the past in your experience.
I see. My biggest challenge, personally speaking, is enunciating all the words.
Okay, well, I'm playing Lady Bracknell, and it's a part I've always wanted to play. I studied the play for my degree, so I know it quite well, and Lady Bracknell was the part that really spoke to me at the time. I think it's because she gets to stomp about quite a bit and be quite sort of nasty to everybody. She is really a gorgon, as they say in the play, so I quite like doing that, quite like being bossy.
Yeah, I think Gwendolyn's a really good part, actually. She's quite funny, she's quite feisty for a girl of her time, so yeah, it's my kind of girl. Very wordy, lots of big words and blah, 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 blah. So, you know, tongue in the teeth, the tip of the lips and all that jazz.
The play itself, I've done a little bit of work with it before. But yeah, like as I'm reading it more and understand it more, I'm getting more to grips with it. It's really something to sink my teeth into.
I think it's an interesting part because, you know, it's this canon, this man of the cloth, but underneath he's a human being, really, and he's denied, well, he thinks he's been denied certain feelings anyway over years, and people think he should behave in a certain way. At the end of the day, he's a human being, and he likes Miss Prism.
I think she's a fun character, really. She's done a lot with her life, but there's more that she wants to do, that she doesn't feel that she can come out and say and do without the help of the canon.
Occupation as watering the flowers is rather Moulton's duty than yours, especially when intellectual pleasures await you. Your German grammar is on the table. Pray, open it at page 15. We will repeat yesterday's lesson.
But I don't like German. It isn't at all a becoming language. I know perfectly well I look quite plain after my German lessons.
Child, you know how anxious your guardian is that you should improve yourself in every way. He laid particular stress on your German as he was leaving for town yesterday. Indeed, he always lays stress on your German when he is leaving for town.
Dear Uncle Jack is so very serious. Sometimes he's so serious, I think he cannot be quite well.
Your guardian enjoys the best of health, and his gravity of demeanour is especially to be commended in someone so comparatively young as he is. I know no one who has a higher sense of duty and responsibility.
I suppose that's why he often looks a little bored when we three are together.
Cecily, I'm surprised at you. Mr. Worthing has many troubles in his life. Idle merriment and triviality would be out of place in his conversation. You must remember his constant anxiety about that unfortunate young man, his brother.
I wish Uncle Jack would allow that unfortunate young man, his brother, to come down here sometime. We might have a good influence over him, Miss Prism. You certainly would. You know German and geology and things of that kind can influence a man very much.
I do not think that even I could produce any effect on a character that, according to his own brother's admission, is irretrievably weak and vacillating. Indeed, I am not sure that I would desire to reclaim him. I am not in favour of this modern mania for turning bad people into good people at a moment's notice. As a man sows, so let him reap. You must put away your diary, Cecily. I really don't see why you should keep a diary at all.
I keep a diary in order to enter the wonderful secrets of my life. If I didn't write them down, I'd be sure to forget all about them.
Memory, my dear Cecily, is the diary that we all carry about with us.
Yes, and it usually chronicles the things that have never happened. and couldn't possibly have happened. I believe memory is responsible for nearly all the three-volume novels that Moody sends us.
Do not speak slightingly of the three-volume novel, Cecily. I wrote one myself in my earlier days.
Did you really, Miss Prism? How wonderfully clever you are. I hope it didn't end happily. I don't like novels that end happily. They depress me so much.
The good ended happily, and the bad unhappily. That is what fiction means,
I suppose, but it seems very unfair. And was your novel ever published?
Alas, no. The manuscript was unfortunately abandoned. I use the word in the sense of lost or mislaid.
Do your work, child. These speculations are profitless. But I see dear Dr. Chasuble coming up through the garden.
Oh, Dr. Chasuble, this is indeed a pleasure.
And how are we this morning? Miss Prism, you are, I trust, well.
Miss Prism has just been complaining of a slight headache. I think it would do her so much good to go for a short stroll with you, Doctor, in the park.
Cecily, I have not mentioned anything about a headache.
No, dear Miss Prism, I know, but I felt instinctively that you had a headache. Indeed, I was thinking about that and not about my German lessons when the rector came in.
I hope, Cecily, you are not inattentive.
I am. Afraid I am.
That is strange. Were I fortunate enough to be Miss Prism's pupil, I would hang upon her lips. I spoke metaphorically. My metaphor was drawn from bees. Mr. Worthing, I suppose, has not returned from town yet.
We do not expect him till Monday afternoon.
Oh, yes. He usually likes to spend his Sunday in London. He's not one of those who's so lame as enjoyment, as by all accounts that unfortunate young man, his brother, seems to be. But I must not disturb Egeria and her pupil any longer.
Egeria? My name is Letitia, Doctor.
A classical allusion, merely, drawn from the pagan authors. I shall see you both, no doubt, at evensong.
I think I will have a stroll with you, Doctor. I find I have a headache after all, and a walk might do it good.
With pleasure, Miss Prism. With pleasure. We might go as far as the schools and back.
Cecily, you will study your political economy in my absence. The chapter on the fall of the rupee you may omit. It is somewhat too sensational. Even these metallic problems have their melodramatic side.
Horrid political economy. Horrid geography. Horrid, horrid German.
Mr. Ernest Worthing has driven from the station. His man has brought his luggage with him.
Mr. Ernest Worthing, B4, the Albany W. Uncle Jack's brother. Did you tell him Mr. Worthing was in town?
Yes, miss, he seemed very much disappointed. I mentioned that you and Miss Prism were in the garden. He said he was anxious to speak with you privately for a moment.
Pray, ask Mr. Worthing to come here, and I suppose you better speak to the housekeeper about a room for him.
Yes, miss.
I have never met any really wicked person before. I feel rather frightened. I'm so afraid he'll look just like everybody else. Oh, he does.
You are my little cousin Cecily, I'm sure.
You are under some strange mistake. I am not little. In fact, I believe I am more than unusually tall for my age. But I am your cousin, Cecily. You, I see from your card, are Uncle Jack's brother. My cousin Ernest. My wicked cousin Ernest.
Well, I'm not really wicked at all. You mustn't think that I am wicked, cousin Cecily.
If you are not, then you certainly have been deceiving us all in a very inexcusable manner. Pretending to be wicked and being really good all the time, that would be hypocrisy.
I suppose I have been rather reckless.
I'm glad to hear it.
In fact, now you mention the subject, I have been very bad in my own small way.
I don't think you should be so proud of that. I'm sure it was very pleasant.
It's much pleasanter to be here with you.
I can't understand how you are here at all. Uncle Jack won't be back until Monday afternoon.
Well, that is a great disappointment. I'm obliged to go up by the first train on Monday morning. I have a business appointment that I'm anxious to miss.
Couldn't you miss it anywhere but London?
I'm afraid not. The appointment is in London.
Well, I know. Of course, how important it is not to keep a business engagement if one wants to retain any sense of beauty of life. But I still think you should wait until Uncle Jack arrives. I know he wants to speak to you about your emigrating.
My what?
Your emigrating. He's gone up to buy your outfit.
I wouldn't let Jack buy my outfit. He has no taste in neckties at all.
I don't think you require neckties. Uncle Jack's sending you to Australia.
Australia? I'd sooner die.
Well, he said at dinner on Wednesday night that you would have to choose between this world, the next world, and Australia.
Well, the accounts I have received of Australia and of the next world are not particularly encouraging. This world is good enough for me, Cousin Cecily.
Yes, but are you good enough for it?
Well, I'm afraid I'm not, no. That is why I would like you to reform me. You might make that your mission if you don't mind.
I have no time this afternoon.
Well, would you mind by reforming myself this afternoon?
It is very quixotic of you, but I think you should try.
I will. I feel better already.
You're looking a little worse.
Oh, well, that's just because I'm hungry.
How thoughtless of me. I should have remembered that when one is going to lead an entirely new life, one requires regular and wholesome meals. Won't you come in?
Thank you. Might I have a buttonhole first? I find I never really have much of an appetite unless I have a buttonhole first.
Pom-pom de Paris?
No. I'd sooner have a pink rose.
Why?
Well, because you are like a pink rose, Cousin Cecily.
I don't think it'd be right you should talk to me like that. Miss Prism never says such things.
Well, then Miss Prism is a short-sighted old lady. You are the prettiest girl I ever saw.
Miss Prism says that all good looks are a snare.
Well, they are a snare. A snare that any sensible man would like to be caught.
Oh, I wouldn't care to catch a sensible man. I shouldn't know what to talk to him about.
You are too much alone, dear Dr. Chasuble. You should get married. A misanthrope, I can understand. A womanthrope, never.
Believe me, I do not deserve so neologistic a phrase. The precept, as well as the practice of the primitive church, was distinctly against matrimony.
That is obviously the reason why the primitive church has not lasted up to the present day. And you do not seem to realize, dear doctor, that by persistently remaining single, a man converts himself into a permanent public temptation. Men should be more careful. This very celibacy leads weaker vessels astray.
But is a man not equally attractive when married?
No married man is ever attractive except to his wife.
And often I've been told, not even to her.
That depends on the intellectual sympathies of the woman. Maturity can be depended on. Ripeness can be trusted. Young women are green. Ooh, I spoke horticulturally. My metaphor was drawn from fruits. But where is Cecily?
Perhaps she followed us to the schools.
Oh, Mr. Worthing.
Mr. Worthing?
This is indeed a surprise. We did not look for you till Monday afternoon.
I have returned sooner than I expected. Dr. Chasuble, I trust you are well.
Dear Mr. Worthing, I trust this garb of woe does not betoken some terrible calamity.
My brother.
Oh, more shameful debts and extravagance.
Still leading his life of leisure.
Dead!
Brother Ernest, dead?
Quite dead.
What a blessing for him. I trust he will profit by it.
May I offer you my sincere condolence? You have at least the consolation of knowing that you were always the most generous and forgiving of brothers.
Poor Ernest. He had many faults. But it is a sad, sad blow.
Very sad indeed. Were you with him at the end?
No, he passed away abroad. In Paris, in fact. I received a telegram last night from the manager of the Grand Hotel.
And was the cause of death mentioned?
a severe chill, it seems.
As a man sows, so shall he reap.
Charity, dear Miss Prism, charity. None of us are perfect. I myself am peculiarly susceptible to drafts. Will the interment take place here?
No, he appears to have expressed a desire to be buried in Paris.
Paris? I fear that hardly points to any very serious state of mind at the last. No doubt you would wish me to make some slight allusion to this tragic domestic affliction next Sunday. My sermon on the meaning of the manna in the wilderness can be adapted to almost any occasion. Joyful, or as in the present case, distressing. I have preached it at harvest celebrations, christenings, confirmations, on days of humiliation, and festal days. The last time I delivered it was in the cathedral as a charity sermon on behalf of the Society for the Prevention of Discontent among the Upper Orders. The bishop who was present was much struck by some of the analogies I drew.
That reminds me, Dr. Chasuble, you mentioned christenings, I think. I suppose you know how to christen all right. Oh, I mean, of course, you are continually christening, aren't you?
It is, I regret to say, one of the rector's more constant duties in this parish. I have often spoken to the poorer classes on the subject, but they don't seem to know what thrift is.
But is there any particular infant in whom you are interested, Mr. Worthing? Your brother was, I believe, unmarried, was he not? Oh,
yes.
People who live entirely for pleasure usually are.
Oh, but it's not for any child, dear doctor. No, I'm particularly fond of children. No, the truth is, I would like to be christened myself, this afternoon, if that would suit you.
Surely Mr. Worthing could have been christened already.
I don't remember anything about it. Of course, I don't know if the thing would bother you in any way, or if you feel perhaps I'm a little too old now.
Oh, not at all. In fact, the sprinkling, indeed, the immersion of adults is a perfectly canonical practice.
Immersion?
You need have no apprehensions. Sprinkling is all that is necessary, and indeed I think advisable. Our weather is so changeable. At what hour would you wish to serenade the form?
I might trot around about 5, if that would suit you.
Perfectly, perfectly. In fact, I have 2 similar ceremonies to perform at that time. A case of twins that occurred recently in one of the outlying cottages on your own estate. Poor Jenkins the carter, a most hard-working man.
No, I don't see any fun in being christened along with other children. No, it would be childish. How would 5:30 suit you?
Admirably, admirably. And now, Mr. Worthing, I will no longer intrude into a house of sorrow. I would merely beg you not to be too much bowed down by grief. What seem to us bitter trials, or very often blessings in disguise.
This seems to me a blessing of an extremely obvious.
Uncle Jack, I'm so pleased to see you back. But what horrid clothes you have on. Do go and change.
Listen,
my child.
What is the matter, Uncle Jack? So you have toothache. And I've such a surprise for you. Who do you think is in the dining room? Your brother.
Who?
Your brother, Ernest. He arrived about 30 minutes ago.
That's absurd. I don't have any brother, Ernest.
Oh, don't say that, Uncle Jack. No matter how badly he may have behaved to you in the past, he is still your brother. You couldn't be so heartless as to disown him. I'll tell him to come out here and you'll shake hands with him, won't you, Uncle Jack?
These are very joyful tidings.
After we had all been resigned to his loss, his sudden return seems to me peculiarly distressing.
My brother is in the dining room. I don't know what all of this means. I think it is perfectly absurd.
Ah, good heavens. I've come down from town to tell you, I'm very sorry for all the trouble I've caused you, that I intend to lead a better life in the future.
Uncle Jack, you're not going to refuse your own brother's hand.
Nothing will induce me to take his hand. He knows, I think his coming here is perfectly disgraceful. He knows exactly well why.
Don't say that, Uncle Jack. Do be nice. There is some good in everyone. Ernest has just been telling me about his poor invalid friend, Mr. Bunbury, whom he goes to visit so often. And surely there must be good in one who is kind to an invalid and leaves the pleasure of London to sit by a bed of pain.
Oh, he's been talking about Bunbury, has he?
Yes, he's told me all about poor Bunbury and his terrible state of health.
Bunbury. Well, I want to hear anything else about Bunbury or anything else at all. It is enough to drive one perfectly frantic.
Well, I admit that the faults were all mainly on my side. But I must say, I think Brother John's coldness towards me is peculiarly painful. I expected a more enthusiastic welcome, especially considering this is the first time I've come here.
Uncle Jack, if you don't shake hands with Ernest, I will never forgive you.
You'll never forgive me?
Never, never, never.
Very well. But this will be the last time I ever do it.
Oh, it's pleasant, is it not, to see so perfect a reconciliation? I think we might leave the two brothers together.
Cecily, you will come with us. Certainly, Miss Prism. My little task of reconciliation is over.
You have done a beautiful action today, dear chap.
You must not be premature in our judgment.
Well, I feel very happy.
You young scoundrel, Algy, you must leave this place at once. I do not allow bombering here.
I have put Mr. Ernest's things in the room next to yours. I suppose that is all right.
What?
His luggage, sir. I have unpacked it and put it in the room next to your own.
His luggage?
Yes, sir. 3 portmanteaus, a dressing case, 2 hat boxes, and a large luncheon basket.
Yes, I'm afraid I can't stay any longer than a week this time.
Harriman, call the dog cart at once. Mr. Ernest has been called suddenly back to town.
Yes, sir.
What a fearful liar you are, Jack. I've not been called back to town at all.
Yes, you have.
I haven't heard anyone call me.
Your duty as a gentleman calls you back.
My duty as a gentleman has never interfered with my pleasures in the smallest degree.
I can't quite believe that.
Besides, Cecily is a darling.
You are not to speak of Miss Cardew that way. I do not like it.
Well, I don't like your clothes. You're perfectly ridiculous in them. Why on earth did you go up and change? Perfectly childish to be in deep mourning for a man who is actually staying with you for a whole week in your house as a guest. I call it grotesque.
You are certainly not staying at my house for a week as a guest or as anything else. You must leave by the 4:05 train.
I certainly can't leave so long as you're in mourning. It would have been most unkind of me. You would stay with me, I suppose. In fact, I would think it most unkind if you didn't.
Very well. If I change my clothes, will you leave?
Yes, as long as you don't take too long. I never saw anybody take so long to dress with such little result.
In either case, this is better than being always overdressed, as you always are.
Well, if I am occasionally a little overdressed, I make up for it by being always immensely overeducated.
Your vanity is ridiculous. Your conduct's an outrage, and your appearance in my garden is utterly absurd. Still, you must leave by the 4:05 train. And I do hope you will have a pleasant journey back to town. This bumbrying, as you call it, has not been a great success for you.
I think it has been a great success. I am in love with Cecily. That is everything. But I must see her before I go. And make arrangements for another bumbry. Ah, there she is.
Oh, I merely came back to water the roses. I thought you were with Uncle Jack.
No, he's gone to send the dog cart for me.
Oh, taking you for a nice drive, is he?
No, he's going to send me away.
Then we've got to part.
I'm afraid so. It's a very painful parting.
It is always painful to part from people to whom one has known a very brief space in time. The absence of old friends one can endure with equanimity. But even a momentary separation from anyone to whom one has just been introduced is almost unbearable.
Thank you.
The dog cart is waiting at the door, sir.
It can wait, Merriman, for 5 minutes.
Yes, miss.
Cecily, I hope I shall not offend you if I state quite frankly and openly that you seem to me to be in every way the visible personification of absolute perfection.
I think your frankness does you credit, Ernest. If you will allow me, I will copy your remarks into my diary.
Do you really keep a diary? I give anything to look at it. May I?
Oh, no. It is simply a very young girl's record of her thoughts and impressions, and consequently meant for publication. When it appears in volume form, I hope you will order a copy. But pray, Ernest, don't stop. I delight in taking down from dictation. I have reached absolute perfection. You can go on. I'm quite ready for more. Don't cough, Ernest. When one is dictating, one should speak fluently and not cough. Besides, I don't know how to spell a cough.
Cecily, ever since I first looked upon your wonderful and incomparable beauty, I have dared to love you wildly, passionately, devotedly, or hopelessly.
Oh, I don't think you should tell me you love me wildly, passionately, devotedly, hopelessly. Hopelessly doesn't make much sense, does it?
Cecily.
The dog cart is waiting, sir.
Tell it to come around next week at the same hour.
Yes, sir.
Uncle Jack would be very much annoyed if he knew you were staying on next week at the same hour.
I don't care about Jack. I don't care for anybody in the whole world but you. I love you, Cecily. You will marry me, won't you?
You silly boy, of course. Why, we've been engaged for the last 3 months.
The last 3 months?
Yes. It'll be exactly 3 months on Thursday.
How did we become engaged?
Well, ever since Uncle Jack first confessed to us that he had a younger brother whom was wicked and bad, you, of course, have formed the chief topic of conversation between myself and Miss Prism. And a man who is much talked about is very attractive. One feels there must be something in him after all. I dare say it was foolish of me, but I fell in love with you, Ernest.
Darling, when was the engagement actually settled?
On the 14th of February last. Worn out by your entire ignorance of my existence, I determined to end the matter one way or another. And after a long struggle with myself, I accepted you. The next day, I went out and bought this little ring in your name. And this little bangle with the true lover's knot I promised you always to wear.
Can I get you this? It's very pretty, isn't it?
Yes, you've wonderfully good taste, Ernest. It's the excuse I've always given for you leading such a bad life. And this is a little box in which I keep all your dear letters.
My letters? But, my sweet Cecily, I've never written you any letters.
You need hardly remind me of that. I remember only too well that I was forced to write your letters for you. I wrote always 3 times a week and sometimes oftener.
Do let me read them, Cecily.
Oh, no, I couldn't possibly. They'll make you far too conceited. Besides, the three I wrote you after I broke off the engagement are so beautiful and so badly spelled that even now I can hardly read them without crying a little.
But was our engagement ever broken off?
Yes, of course. On the 22nd of March last, you can see the entry if you like. Today I broke off engagement with Ernest, feel it better to do so. Weather still continues charming.
Why did you break it off? What had I done? I had done nothing at all, Cecily. Cecily, I'm very much right indeed if you broke it off. Particularly when the weather was so charming.
Well, it wouldn't have been a really serious engagement if I hadn't broken it off at least once. But I forgave you before the week was out.
Perfect angel you are.
You dear romantic boy. I like your hair so much. Does it come naturally?
Yes, with a little help from others.
I'm so glad.
And you'll never break off our engagement again?
Not now that I've actually met you. Besides, there is the question of your name.
Yes, of course.
You mustn't laugh at me, darling, but it has always been a girlish dream of mine to love somebody with the name of Ernest. There's something in their name that inspires absolute confidence. I pity any poor married woman whose husband is not called Ernest.
But my own sweet Cecily, you don't mean to say you couldn't love me if I had some other name?
But what name?
Well, any name you like.
Algernon, for instance.
I don't like the name Algernon.
Oh, well, my own dear, sweet, loving little darling, I really can't see why you should object to the name of Algernon. It is not at all a bad name. In fact, it is rather an aristocratic name. By half of the chaps who get into the bankruptcy court are called Algernon. But seriously, Cecily, if my name was Algy, couldn't you love me?
I might respect you, Ernest. I might admire your character, but I fear I would not be able to give you my undivided attention.
Cecily, your rector here is, I suppose, thoroughly experienced in the rites and ceremonials of the church.
Yes, Dr. Chasuble is a most learned man. He's never written one single book, so you can imagine how much he knows.
Then I must see him at once on the most important most important business.
Oh.
I shan't be away more than half an hour.
Considering that we've been engaged since February the 14th, and that I've met you today for the first time, I think it rather hard you should leave me for so long a period as half an hour. Couldn't you make it 20 minutes?
I'll be back in no time.
What an impetuous boy he is. I like his hair so much. I'll enter his proposal into my diary.
Miss Fairfax has called to see Mr. Worthing on some very important business, Miss Fairfax states.
Is it Mr. Worthing in his library?
Mr. Worthing was on his way in the direction of the rectory some time ago.
Pray, ask the lady to come here and speak to the maid about some tea.
Yes, miss.
Miss Fairfax. I suppose one of the many good elderly women who associates with Uncle Jack in some of his philanthropic work in London. I don't like women who are interested in philanthropic work. I think it's rather forward of them.
Miss Fairfax.
Pray, allow me to introduce myself. I'm Cecily Cardew.
Cecily Cardew. What a very sweet name. Something tells me we are going to be great friends. I like you already more than I can say. My first impressions of people are never wrong.
How nice of you to like me so much, even though we've known each other such a comparatively short time. Pray, sit down.
I may call you Cecily, may I not?
With pleasure.
And you will always call me Gwendolyn, won't you?
If you wish.
Then it is all quite settled, is it not?
I hope so.
Perhaps this might be a favourable opportunity for my mentioning who I am. My father is Lord Bracknell. You have never heard of Papa, I suppose.
I don't think so.
Outside the family circle, Papa, I am glad to say, is entirely unknown. I think that is quite as it should be. The home seems to me to be the proper sphere for the man, and certainly once a man begins to neglect his domestic duties, he becomes painfully effeminate, does he not? And I don't quite like that. It makes men so very attractive. Cecily, Mama, whose views on education are remarkably strict, has brought me up to be extremely short-sighted. It is part of her system. So, do you mind my looking at you through my glasses?
Not at all, Gwendolyn. In fact, I'm very fond of being looked at.
You are here on a short visit, I suppose.
Oh, no, I live here.
Really? Your mother, no doubt, or some female relative of advanced years, resides here also.
No, I have no mother, nor, in fact, any relations.
Indeed.
My guardian, with the assistance of Miss Prism, has an arduous task of looking after me.
Your guardian?
Yes, I am Mr. Worthing's ward.
Oh, it's strange. He never mentioned to me that he had a ward. How secretive of him. He grows more interesting hourly. I'm not sure, however, the news inspires me with feelings of unmixed delight. I'm very fond of you, Cecily. I've liked you ever since I met you. But I am bound to state that now that I know that you are Mr. Worthing's ward, I cannot help expressing a wish that you were, well, just a little older than you appear to be, and not quite so very alluring in appearance. In fact, if I may speak candidly...
Pray do. I think that when one has anything unpleasant to say, one should speak quite candid.
Well, to speak with perfect candor, Cecily, I wish that you were fully 42 and more than usually plain for your age. Ernest has a strong, upright nature. He is the very soul of truth and honor. Disloyalty would be as impossible to him as deception. But even men of the noblest possible moral character are extremely susceptible to the influence of the physical charms of others. Modern, no less ancient history supplies us with many most painful examples of what I refer to. If it were not so, indeed history would be quite unreadable.
I beg your pardon, Gwendolyn. Did you say Ernest?
Yes.
Why, it is not Mr. Ernest Worthing who is my guardian. It is his brother, his elder brother.
Oh. He never mentioned to me that he had a brother.
I'm sorry to say they have not been on good terms for a long time.
That accounts for it. And now that I think of it, I have never heard any man mention his brother. The subject seems distasteful to most men. Cecily, you have lifted a load from my mind. I was growing almost anxious. It would be terrible if a cloud had come across a friendship like ours, would it not? Of course, you are quite certain that it is not Mr. Ernest Worthing who is your guardian.
Quite sure. In fact, I'm going to be his.
I beg your pardon?
There's no reason why I should make it a secret to you, dear Gwendolyn. Our little county newspaper is sure to chronicle the fact next week. Mr. Ernest Worthing and I are engaged to be married.
My darling Cecily, I'm afraid there must be some slight error. Mr. Ernest Worthing is engaged to be married to me. The announcement will appear in the Morning Post on Saturday morning at the latest.
There must be some misconception, dear Gwendolyn, for Ernest proposed to me exactly 10 minutes ago.
It is very curious, for he asked me to be his wife yesterday afternoon at 5:30. If you would care to verify the incident, pray do so. I never travel without my diary. One should always have something sensational to read in the train. I'm so sorry, dear Cecily, if it is any disappointment to you, but I'm afraid I have the prior claim.
It would distress me more than I can tell you, dear Gwendolyn, if it causes you any mental or physical anguish. But I feel bound to point out that since Ernest proposed to you, he has clearly changed his mind.
If the poor fellow has been entrapped into any foolish promise, I shall consider it my duty to rescue him at once and with a firm hand.
Do you suggest, Miss Fairfax, that I entrapped Ernest into an engagement? How dare you? This is no time for wearing the shallow mask of manners. When I see a spade, I call it a spade.
I am glad to say I have never seen a spade. It is obvious that our social spheres have been widely different.
Shall we lay tea, as usual, miss?
Yes, as usual.
Are there any interesting walks in the vicinity, Miss Cardew?
Yes, quite a many, actually. On top of one of the hills, quite close, one can see 5 counties.
5 counties? I don't think I should like that. I hate crowds.
I suppose that's why you live in town.
Quite a well-kept garden this is, Miss Cardew.
So glad you like it, Miss Fairfax.
I had no idea there were any flowers in the country.
Oh, flowers are as common here as people are in London.
Personally, I cannot understand how anybody manages to exist in the country, if anybody who is anybody does. The country always bores me to death.
Oh, this is what the newspapers call agricultural depression, is it not? I believe the aristocracy are suffering from it just at present. It is practically an epidemic amongst them, so I have been told. May I offer you some tea, Miss Fairfax?
Thank you. Detestable girl. I require tea.
Sugar?
No, thank you. Sugar is not fashionable anymore.
Hand that to Miss Fairfax. or bread and butter?
Bread and butter, please. Cake is rarely seen in the best houses nowadays.
And that.
You have filled my tea with lumps of sugar. And though I asked most distinctly for bread and butter, you have given me cake. I am known for the gentleness of my disposition and the extraordinary sweetness of my nature. But I warn you, Miss Cardew, you may go too far.
To save my poor, innocent, trusting boy from the machinations of any other girl, there are no lengths to which I will not go.
From the moment I saw you, I distrusted you. I felt that you were false and deceitful. I am never deceived in such matters. My first impressions of people are invariably right.
It seems to me, Miss Fairfax, that I am trespassing on your valuable time. No doubt you have many other calls of a similar character to make in the neighbourhood.
Ernest! My own Ernest!
What?
A moment. May I ask, are you engaged to be married to this young lady?
To Cecily? Oh, what could have put such an idea into your pretty little head?
Thank you. You may.
I knew there must have been some misunderstanding, Miss Fairfax. For the gentleman whose arm is at present round your waist is my guardian, Mr. John Worthing.
I beg your pardon?
This is Uncle Jack.
Jack? Oh,
my own one.
Here is Ernest. A moment, Ernest. If I may ask, are you engaged to be married to this young lady?
To what young lady? Good heavens, Gwendolyn!
Yes, good heavens, Gwendolyn. No, I mean to Gwendolyn.
Of course not. What could have put such an idea into your pretty head?
Thank you, you may.
I felt that there was some slight error, Miss Cardew. The gentleman who is now embracing you is my cousin, Mr. Algernon Moncrieff.
Algernon Moncrieff? Oh! Are you really called Algernon?
I cannot deny it.
Is your name really John?
I could deny it if I liked. I could deny anything if I liked. But my name certainly is John. It has been John for years.
A gross deception has been practiced on both of us, Gwendolyn.
My poor wronged Cecily.
My sweet wronged Gwendolyn.
You will always call me sister, will you not?
There is just one question I would like to put to my guardian.
An admirable idea. Mr. Worthing, there is just one question I would like to be permitted to put to you. Where is your brother Ernest? We are both engaged to be married to your brother Ernest, and so it is of some importance to us to know where your brother Ernest is at present.
Gwendolyn, Cecily, it is very painful for me to be forced to speak the truth. It is the first time in my whole life I have ever been reduced to such a painful position, and I really am quite inexperienced at doing anything of the kind. However, I must inform you quite frankly that I have no brother. I never have had a brother, and I never will have a brother, not even of any kind.
No brother at all?
None.
Not even of any kind?
Never. Not even of any kind.
Darling Cecily, I'm afraid that neither of us is engaged to be married to anyone.
It is not a pleasant position for a young girl to suddenly find herself in, is it?
Let us go into the house. They will hardly venture after us there.
No, men are so cowardly, aren't they?
This mess is what you might call bumbrying, I suppose.
Yes, and a perfectly wonderful bumbry it is.
Well, you have no right at all to bumbry here.
That's absurd. One has a right to bumbry anywhere one chooses. Every serious bumbryist knows that.
Serious bumbryist? Good heavens.
Well, one must be serious about something. One wants to retain any amusements in life. I happen to be serious about Bunbury. What on earth are you serious about? I haven't got the remotest idea. About everything, I should fancy. You have such an absolutely trivial nature.
Well, the only small satisfaction that I have about this whole horrific mess is that your friend Mr. Bunbury is quite exploded.
You won't be able to run down to the country as often as you used to, dear Algy, and a very good thing, too.
But your brother is a little off colour, isn't he, dear Jack? You won't be able to disappear up to town quite so often as your wicked custom was. Not a bad thing, either.
As for your taking in a simple, sweet, innocent girl like Miss Cardew, I think your conduct is perfectly disgraceful, to say nothing of the fact that she is my ward.
Well, I can see no possible defence at all. You're deceiving a brilliant, clever, thoroughly experienced young lady like Miss Fairfax, to say nothing of the fact that she is my cousin.
I simply wanted to be engaged to Gwendolyn, that is all. I love her!
I merely wanted to become engaged to Cecily. I adore her.
There is certainly no chance of your marrying Miss Cardew.
I don't think there's much chance, Jack. You and Miss Fairfax being united.
Well, that is no business of yours.
But if it was my business, I wouldn't talk about it. It's very rude to talk of one's own business. Only people like stockbrokers do that, and then merely at dinner parties.
How can you sit there, calmly eating muffins, when we are in this horrific mess? I can't quite make it out. You seem to me to be perfectly heartless.
Well, I can't eat muffins in an agitated manner. The butter would probably get on my cuffs. One should always eat muffins perfectly calmly. It's the only way to eat them.
I say it is perfectly heartless you're eating muffins at all under the circumstances.
When I'm in trouble, eating is the only thing that consoles me. Indeed, when I'm in really great trouble, as anyone who knows me intimately will tell you, I refuse everything except food and drink. Present moment, I'm eating muffins because I'm unhappy. Besides, I happen to be particularly fond of muffins.
And you needn't eat them in that greedy way.
I wish you'd have tea cake instead. I don't like tea cake.
My God, I suppose a man may eat his own muffins in his own garden.
Yes, but you've just said it is perfectly heartless to eat muffins.
I said it was perfectly heartless of you under the circumstances. That is a very different thing.
That may be, but the muffins are the same.
Algy, why won't you leave?
You can't possibly expect me to go without having some dinner. I never go without my dinner. Nobody ever does, except vegetarians and people like that. Besides, I have just made arrangements with Dr. Chasuble to be christened at 6:15 under the name of Ernest.
My dear fellow, the sooner you give up that nonsense, the better. I've already made arrangements myself to be christened by Dr. Chasuble at 5:30. I will naturally take the name of Ernest. Gwendolyn would wish it. We cannot both be called Ernest. It is absurd. And besides, I have every right to be christened if I want to. There is no record at all of me ever having been christened. It is entirely different in your case. You have been christened already.
Yes, but I have not been christened for years.
But you have been christened. That's the important thing.
Quite so. So I know my constitution can stand it. I must say, if you're not quite sure about your ever having been christened, it is rather dangerous you're venturing on it now. It might make you very unwell. You can hardly have forgotten that someone very closely connected with you is very nearly carried off this week in Paris by a severe chill.
Yes, but you said that a severe chill is not hereditary or anything of the kind.
Well, it used to be, I know. But I dare say it is now. Science is always making such wonderful improvements in things.
But that is nonsense.
Jack, you are at the muffins again. I wish you wouldn't. I told you, I'm particularly fond of muffins.
But I hate tea cake.
But then why on earth do you allow it to be served up to your guests? The ideas you have on hospitality.
Oh, Algy, I've asked you to go. Why don't you go?
Because I haven't quite finished my tea yet. Besides, there's still one muffin left.
follow us at once into the house, as anyone else would have done, seems to me to show that they have some sense of shame left.
They've been eating muffins. That looks like repentance.
They don't seem to notice us at all. Couldn't you cough?
But I haven't got a cough. Mm.
They're looking at us. Effrontery.
They're approaching. That's very forward of them.
Let us preserve a dignified silence.
Certainly. It seems the only thing to do now.
This dignified silence seems to produce an unpleasant effect.
A most distasteful one.
But we will not be the first to speak.
Certainly not.
Mr. Worthing, I have something very particular to say to you. Much depends on your reply.
Gwendolyn, your common sense is invaluable. Mr. Moncrieff, kindly answer me the following question. Why did you pretend to be my guardian's brother?
Well, in order that I might have an opportunity of meeting you.
That certainly seems a satisfactory explanation, does it not?
Yes, dear, if you can believe him.
I don't. But that does not affect the wonderful beauty of his answer.
True. In matters of grave importance, style, not sincerity, is the vital thing. Mr. Worthing, what explanation can you offer to me for pretending to have a brother? Was it in order that you might have an opportunity of coming up to town to see me as often as possible?
Can you doubt it, Miss Fairfax?
I have the gravest doubts on the subject, but I intend to crush them. This is not the moment for German scepticism. Their explanations seem quite satisfactory, especially Mr. Worthing's. That seems to me to have the stamp of truth upon it.
I am more than content with what Mr. Moncrieff said. His voice alone inspires one with absolute credulity.
Then you think we should forgive them?
Yes. I mean no.
True. I had forgotten. There are principles at stake that one cannot surrender. Which of us should tell them? The task is not a pleasant one.
Couldn't we both speak at the same time?
An excellent idea. I nearly always speak at the same time as other people. Will you take the time from me?
Certainly. Your Christian names are still an insuperable barrier. That is all.
Our Christian names? Is that all? But we're going to be christened this afternoon.
For my sake, you are prepared to do this terrible thing.
I am.
To face this fearful ordeal, you are ready to do it for me.
I am.
How absurd to talk about the equality of the sexes. Where questions of self-sacrifice are concerned, men are infinitely beyond us.
We are.
They have moments of physical courage that us women know absolutely nothing.
Darling.
My own one.
Cecily, darling.
Good heavens. Lady Bramble.
Gwendolyn, what does this mean?
Merely that I am engaged to be married to Mr. Worthing, Mama.
Come here. Sit down. Sit down immediately. Hesitation of any kind is a sign of mental decay in the young, of physical weakness in the old. Apprised, sir, of my daughter's sudden flight by her trusty maid, whose confidence I purchased by means of a small coin, I followed her at once by a luggage train. Her unhappy father is, I am glad to say, under the impression that she is attending a more than usually lengthy lecture by the University Extension Scheme on the influence of a permanent income on thought. I do not propose to undeceive him. Indeed, I have never undeceived him on any question. I would consider it wrong. But of course, you must clearly understand that all communication between yourself and my daughter must cease immediately from this moment. On this point, as indeed on all points, I am firm.
I am engaged to be married to Gwendolyn, Lady Bracknell.
You are nothing of the kind, sir. Now, as regards Algernon, Algernon?
Yes, Aunt Augusta.
May I ask if it is in this house that your invalid friend, Mr. Bunbury, resides?
No, Bunbury doesn't live here, Aunt Augusta. In fact, Bunbury is somewhere else at present. In fact, Bunbury is dead.
Dead? When did Mr. Bunbury die? His death must have been extremely sudden.
Oh, he was, it was quite exploded.
Exploded? Was he the victim of a revolutionary outrage? I was not aware that Mr. Bunbury was interested in social legislation. If so, he is well punished for his morbidity.
Well, my dear Aunt Augusta, I mean, he was found out. The doctors, they found out that Bunbury couldn't live anymore, so Bunbury died. Well, that's what I mean.
He seems to have had great confidence in the opinion of his physicians. I am glad, however, that he made up his mind at the last to some definite course of action and acted under proper medical advice. And now that we have finally got rid of this Mr. Bunbury, may I ask, Mr. Worthing, who is that young person whose hand my nephew Algernon is now holding in what seems to me to be a peculiarly unnecessary manner?
That lady is Miss Cecily Cardew, my ward.
Yes, I am engaged to be married to her, Cecily.
I beg your pardon.
Mr. Moncrieff and I are engaged to be married, Lady Bracknell.
I do not know whether there is anything peculiarly exciting in the air in this particular part of Hertfordshire, but the number of engagements that go on seem to me to be considerably above the proper average that statistics have laid down for our guidance. I think some preliminary inquiry on my part would not be out of place. Mr. Worthing, is Miss Cardew at all connected with any of the larger railway stations in London? I merely desire information. Until yesterday, I had no idea there were any families or persons whose origin was a terminus.
Miss Cecily Cardew is the granddaughter of the late Mr. Thomas Cardew of 149 Belgrave Square, South West, Gervase Park, Dorking, Surrey, and the Sporran, Fifeshire, NB.
That sounds not unsatisfactory. Three addresses always inspire confidence, even in tradesmen. But what proof have I of their authenticity?
I have carefully preserved the court guides of the period. They are open to your inspection, Lady Brown.
I have known strange errors in that publication.
Miss Cardew's family solicitors are Messrs. Markby, Markby and Markby.
Markby, Markby and Markby. A firm of the very highest position in their profession. Indeed, I am told that one of the Mr. Markbys is occasionally to be seen at dinner parties. So far, I am satisfied.
How very generous of you, Lady Bracknell. I also have in my possession, you will be pleased to hear, certificates of Miss Cardew's birth, baptism, whooping cough, registration, vaccination, confirmation, and the measles, both the German and the English varieties.
A life crowded with incident, I see, though perhaps somewhat too exciting for a young girl. I am not myself in favour of premature experiences. Gwendolyn, the time approaches for our departure. We have not a moment to lose. As a matter of form, Mr. Worthing, I had better ask you if Miss Cardew has any little fortune.
Oh, only £130,000 in the funds. That is all. Goodbye, Lady Bracknell. So pleased to have seen you.
A moment, Mr. Worthing. £130,000, and in the funds. Miss Cardew seems to me a most attractive young lady. Now that I really look at her, few girls of the present day have any of the really solid qualities, any of the qualities that last and improve with time. We live, I regret to say, in an age of surfaces. Come over here, dear.
Oh,
pretty child. Your dress is sadly simple, and your hair seems almost as nature might have left it. But we can soon alter all that. A thoroughly experienced French maid produces a really marvellous result in a very brief space of time. I remember recommending one to young Lady Lansing, and after 3 months her own husband did not know her.
And after 6 months, nobody knew her.
Kindly turn round, sweet child. No, the side view is what I want. Yes, quite as I expected. There are distinct social possibilities in your profile. The two weak points in our age are its want of principle and its want of profile. The chin a little higher, dear. Style largely depends on the way the chin is worn. They are worn very high just at present. Algernon?
Yes, Aunt Augusta.
There are distinct social possibilities in Miss Cardew's profile.
Cecily is the sweetest, prettiest girl I've ever met. And who cares tuppence about social possibilities?
Never speak disrespectfully of society, Algernon. Only people who can't get into it do that. Dear child, of course you know that Algernon has nothing but his debts to depend upon. But I do not approve of mercenary marriages. When I married Lord Bracknell, I had no fortune of any kind. But I never dreamt for a moment of allowing that to stand in my way. Well, I suppose I must give my consent. Cecily, you may kiss me.
Thank you, Lady Bracknell.
You may also address me as Aunt Augusta for the future.
Thank you, Aunt Augusta.
The marriage, I think, had better take place quite soon. To speak frankly, I am not in favour of long engagements. They give people the opportunity of finding out each other's character before marriage, which I think is never advisable.
I beg your pardon for interrupting, Lady Bracknell, but I'm afraid this marriage is quite out of the question. I am Miss Cardew's guardian. And as such, she cannot marry without my consent until she comes of age. That consent, I absolutely decline to give.
Upon what grounds, may I ask? Algernon is an extremely, I may almost say an ostentatiously eligible young man. He has nothing, but he looks everything. What more can one desire?
It pains me very much to have to speak to you quite frankly about your nephew, Lady Bracknell. However, I do not trust at all in his moral character. I suspect him of being untruthful.
Untruthful? My nephew, Algernon? Impossible. He is an Oxonian.
I'm afraid there can be no possible doubt on the matter. Earlier this afternoon, while I was absent in London on a question of romance, he obtained admission into my house under the false pretense of being my brother. Under an assumed name, he drank, I have just been informed by my butler, an entire pint bottle of my Perrier Jouet Brut 89 wine that I was reserving especially for myself. He consequently stated he devoured every single muffin, after alienating the affections of my only ward. And what makes his conduct all the more heartless is that he knew from the first that I have no brother, that I've never had a brother, and that I never intend to have a brother, not even of any kind. I distinctly told him so myself yesterday afternoon.
Mr. Worthing, after careful consideration, I have decided entirely to overlook my nephew's conduct to you.
How very kind of you, Lady Bracknell. However, my decision still stands. I decline to give my consent.
Come here, sweet child. How old are you, dear?
I'm really only 18, but I'm mid to 20 when I go to evening parties.
You are perfectly right in making some slight alteration. Indeed, no woman should ever be quite accurate about her age. It looks so calculating. 18, but admitting to 20 at evening parties. Well, it will not be so very long before you are of age and free from the restraints of tutelage. So I don't think Your guardian's consent is, after all, a matter of any importance.
I beg your pardon for interrupting you again, Lady Bracknell. However, I must inform you, under the terms of her grandfather's will, Miss Cardew does not legally come of age until she is 35.
That does not seem to me to be a grave objection. 35 is a very attractive age. London society is full of women of the very highest birth who have, of their own free choice, remained 35 for years. Lady Dumbleton is an instance in point. To my own knowledge, she has been 35 ever since she reached the age of 40, which was many years ago now. I see no reason why our own dear Cecily should not be even still more attractive at the age you mentioned than she is at present. A large accumulation of property.
Algy, could you wait for me until I was 35?
Of course I could, Cecily. You know I could.
Yes, I felt instinctively that you could. But I couldn't wait all that time. I hate waiting even 5 minutes for anybody. I'm not punctual myself, I know, but I do like punctuality in others. And waiting even to be married is quite out of the question.
Well, then what is to be done, Cecily?
I don't know, Mr. Moncrieff.
Mr. Worthing, since Miss Cardew states positively that she cannot wait until she is 35, a remark which I am bound to say seems to me to show a somewhat impatient nature, I would beg of you to reconsider your decision.
But Lady Bracknell, the decision is entirely in your own hands. The moment you consent to my marriage with Gwendolyn, I will happily allow your nephew to form an alliance with my ward.
You must be quite aware that what you propose is out of the question.
And a passionate celibacy is all that any of us can look forward to.
That is not the destiny that I propose for Gwendolyn. Algernon, of course, can choose for himself. Come, dear. We have already missed 5, if not 6, trains. To miss any more might expose us to comment on the platform.
Everything is quite ready for the christenings.
The christening, sir? Is that not somewhat premature?
Both these gentlemen have expressed a desire for immediate baptism.
Their age? The idea is grotesque and irreligious. Algernon, I forbid you to be baptized. I will not hear of such excesses. Lord Bracknell would be highly displeased if he learned that that was the way in which you wasted your time and money.
Am I to understand, then, that there are to be no christenings at all this afternoon?
I think that, as things are now, it wouldn't be of much use to either of us, Dr. Chasuble.
I am grieved to hear such sentiment from you, Mr. Worthing. They savour of the heretical views of the Anabaptists, views that I have completely refuted in 4 of my unpublished sermons. Indeed, as your present mood seems to be one particularly secular, I will return to the church at once. Indeed, I have just been told by the pew opener that for the last hour and a half, Miss Prism has been waiting for me in the vestry.
Miss Prism?
Yes.
Did I hear you mention a Miss Prism?
Yes, Lady Racknell. I'm on my way to join her.
Pray, allow me to detain you for a moment. This matter may prove to be of one of vital importance to Lord Bracknell and myself. Is this Miss Prism a female of repellent aspect, remotely connected with education?
She is the most cultivated of ladies, and the very picture of respectability.
Which is obviously the same person. May I ask what the position she holds in your household?
I am a celibate, madam.
Miss Prism, Lady Bracknell, is Miss Cardew's esteemed goddess and valued companion.
In spite of what I hear of her, I must see her at once. Let her be sent for.
She approaches. She is nigh.
I was told you expected me in the vestry, dear Canon. I have been waiting for you there for 1 hour and 3 quarters.
Prism! Come here, Prism! Prism, where is that baby?
And
28 years ago, Prism, you left Lord Bracknell's house, number 104 Upper Grosvenor Street, in charge of a perambulator containing a baby of the male sex. You never returned. A few weeks later, through the elaborate investigations of the Metropolitan Police, the perambulator was discovered at midnight, standing by itself in a remote corner of Bayswater. It contained the manuscript of a three-volume novel of more than usually revolting sentimentality. But the baby was not there. Prism, where is that baby?
Lady Bracknell, I admit with shame that I do not know. I only wish I did. The plain facts of the case are these. On the morning of the day you mention, a day that is forever branded on my memory, I prepared as usual to take the baby out in its perambulator. I had also with me a somewhat old but capacious handbag in which I had intended to place the manuscript of a work of fiction that I had written during my few unoccupied hours. In a moment of mental abstraction for which I can never forgive myself, I deposited the manuscript in the bassinet and placed the baby in the handbag.
But where did you deposit the handbag?
Oh, do not ask me, Mr. Worthing.
Miss Prism, this is a matter of no small importance to myself. I insist on knowing where you deposited the handbag that contained that infant.
I left it in the cloakroom of one of the larger railway stations in London.
Which railway station?
Victoria, the Brighton Line.
I must retire to my room for a moment. Gwendolyn, wait here for me.
Well, if you are not too long, I will wait here for you all my life.
Well, what do you think this means, Lady Bracknell?
I dare not even suspect, Dr. Chasuble. I need hardly tell you that in families of high position, strange coincidences are not supposed to occur. They are hardly considered things.
Uncle Jack seems strangely agitated.
Your guardian has a very emotional nature.
This noise is extremely unpleasant. It sounds as if he was having an argument. I dislike arguments of any kind. They are always vulgar and often convincing.
It has stopped now.
I wish he would arrive at some conclusion.
The suspense is terrible. I hope it will last.
Miss Prism, is this the handbag? Inspect it carefully before you speak. The happiness of more than one life depends on your answer.
It seems to be mine. Yes, here is the injury it received through the upsetting of a Gower Street omnibus in my younger and happier days. And here is the stain on the lining caused by the explosion of a temperance beverage, an incident that occurred at Leamington. Oh, and here on the locker, my initials. I had forgotten that in an extravagant mood I had had them placed there. The bag is undoubtedly mine. I am delighted to have it so unexpectedly restored to me. It has been a great inconvenience being without it all these years.
Miss Prism, more is restored to you than this handbag. I am the infant you placed inside it.
You?
Yes, mother.
Oh, Mr. Worthing, I am unmarried.
Unmarried? Well, I do not deny that that is a serious blow. But then who can throw stones against one who has suffered? Cannot repentance wipe out an act of folly? Why should there be one law for man and another law for women? Mother, I forgive you.
Mr. Worthing, there is the lady who can tell you who you really are.
Lady Bracknell, I hate to seem inquisitive, but would you kindly inform me of who I am?
I am afraid that the news I have to give you will not altogether please you. You are the son of my poor sister, Mrs. Moncrieff, and consequently, Algernon's elder brother.
Algy's elder brother? I always knew I had a brother. I always said I had a brother. Cecily, how could you ever have doubted that I had a brother?
Hello, Ernest! You! This is my brother, Dr. Chasuble, my unfortunate brother, was imprisoned by unfortunate brother Gwendolyn. This is my unfortunate brother. Oh, Algy, you young scoundrel, you shall have to treat me more respect in the future. You've never treated me as a friend, as a brother in all your life.
Yes, well, not until today, old boy, I admit. I tried my best, however, but I was a little out of practice.
My own? But what own are you? What is your Christian name now that you've become someone else?
I had quite forgotten that fact. Your decision on the subject of my name is irrevocable, I suppose.
I never change, except in my affections. What a noble character you have, Gwendolyn.
And the matter must be cleared up at once. Aunt Augusta, a moment. At the time that I had been left in the handbag, had I been christened already?
Every luxury that money could buy, including christening, had been lavished on you by your fond and doting parents.
And I had been christened. That settles it. Now, what was the name that I was given? Give me the worst.
Being the eldest son, you were naturally christened after your father.
Yes, but what was my father's Christian name?
I cannot, at the present moment, recall what the general's Christian name was. But I have no doubt he had one. He was eccentric, I admit, but only in later years, and that was the result of the Indian climate and marriage and indigestion and other things of that kind.
Algy, can't you recall what our father's Christian name was?
Well, my dear boy, we were never even on speaking terms. He died before I was a year old.
His name would appear in the army lists of the period, I suppose, Aunt Augusta.
The general was essentially a man of peace, except in his domestic life. But I have no doubt his name would appear in any military directory.
The army lists of the last 40 years are here. These delightful records should have been my constant study. M. M generals? Mallow, Maxbo, Magley. Ugh, what ghastly names they have. Markby, Migsby, Mobbs, Moncrieff! Captain, 1840, Lieutenant, Lieutenant Colonel, Colonel, General, 1869. Christian names? Ernest John. I always said my name was Ernest, didn't I? Well, my name is Ernest after all. I mean, it naturally is Ernest.
Yes. I remember now that the general was called Ernest. I knew I had a particular reason for disliking that name.
Ernest. My own Ernest. I felt from the first that you could have no other name.
My dear Gwendolyn, it is a great pain for a man to realize that he has been speaking nothing but the truth his whole life. Can you ever forgive me?
I can, for I feel certain that you are sure to change.
My own one.
Letitia!
Oh, Frederick! At last!
At last! Gwendolyn, at last!
My nephew! You seem to be displaying signs of triviality.
On the contrary, Aunt Augusta. I have realized for the first time in my life the vital importance of being earnest.
But I know now that you are sincere. I had fears, but aside I will brush them. Now that your good intentions are clear, I was overcome as I listened to your promise of changing your name. It takes courage and strength to be christened, for it's cold and it's damp, so they claim. So we stand here before you surrendered, and we sign you as long as we live. In return for the trust you engendered, our eternal devotion will give. My devotion,
yes, I pledge.